so appreciate you. Good morning. Welcome to the Butteville Community Church. Kind of a gray, cold, icy, sort of snowy type morning. But I got to tell you, the sun is shining in here. That's the S-O-N, sun, Jesus. If you're watching us from home, now's the time to get another cup of coffee and get settled in. Grab your Bible. We're going to worship the Lord this morning. Shall we stand together as God's people? I'm reading from Psalm 40. I desire to do your will, my God. Your law is within my heart. I proclaim your saving acts in the great assembly. I do not seal my lips, Lord, as you know. I do not hide your righteousness in my heart. I speak of your faithfulness and your saving help. I do not conceal your love and your faithfulness from the great assembly. Indeed, Father, we are gathered here to worship you, the Creator God. We sing praises to your name this morning, Lord. We've come from different places, different situations. Some of us are rejoicing, some of us are hurting. You know that, Lord. We are the sheep of your pasture. We just ask, Lord, that you would surround us with your love. For we pray in our Savior's name. Amen.
Well, we're glad you're all here this morning, and you might notice this is a novelty. It's an all-girl band today. Our youngest member is 11, and our next youngest member over there on the bass is 14, and the rest of us won't tell you how old we are. We're going to start with a little Bible school song just to liven things up, and you probably... possibly at least know this from your childhood.
Give me all in my lamp, keep me burning. Give me all in my lamp, I pray. Give me all in my lamp, keep me burning. Keep me burning till the break of day. Hosanna, sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna to the King. Give me joy in my heart, keep me praising. Give me joy in my heart, I pray. Give me joy in my heart, keep me praising. Keep me praising till the break of day. Sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna to the King. Serving, serving, serving. Give me love in my heart, I pray. Hallelujah. Give me love in my heart. Keep me serving, serving, serving. Keep me serving till the break of day. Why don't you sing Hosanna? Sing Hosanna. Sing Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing Hosanna. Sing Hosanna. Sing Hosanna to the King.
One more time. Why don't you sing
Hosanna, sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna to the King of Kings. Sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna, sing Hosanna to the King.
Now if your voice cracks like mine, it's okay. Just keep singing. It'll warm up, kind of like the weather. We need to stop for children's church. Almost ran over that one. Kids, are you ready to go? If you feel young enough to go to children's church.
I was so enthralled with listening to you all, I got lost there. All right. Junior church, who's ready to go?
You'd think we send only the good-looking ones, but that's really not true.
All right. Thank you, Father, for the gift of children. And Lord, we just ask your blessing upon them in this next few minutes. And we pray these things in your name, Jesus. Amen.
All right. Here's a little 60s song for all of us who thought we were rock and rollers back then.
We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. And we pray that our unity may one day be restored. And they'll know we are Christians by our love. By our love, yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will walk with each other, we will walk hand in hand. We will walk with each other, we will walk hand in hand. And together we'll spread the news that God is in our land. And they'll know we are Christians by our love. By our love, yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will work with each other. We will work side by side. We will work with each other. We will work side by side. And we'll guard each man's dignity and save each man's pride. And they'll know we are Christians by our love. By our love, yes, they'll know are Christians by our love. All praise to the Father from whom all things come, and all praise to Christ Jesus, his only Son, and all praise to the Spirit who makes us one. And they'll know we are Christians by our love. By our love, yes, they'll know we are Christians by our
of this song, please. And it starts, we are one. There we go.
We are one in the bond of love. We are one in the bond of love. We have joined our spirits with the Spirit of God. We are one in the bond.
One more slide. There it is.
Let us sing now, everyone. Let us feel His love begun. Let us join our hands so the world will know we are
Okay, Mike, we're going to pester you some more. Can we go back to We Are One?
We are one in the bond of love. We are one in the bond of love. We have joined our spirits with the Spirit of God. We are one in the bond of love.
We have joined?
We have joined our spirit with the Spirit of God. We are one in the bond of love.
Thank you. Great singing, Sarah. I love having you on the front row. You may be seated. And Marilyn has a preview in a few minutes, but there was one thing left out, I thought, last week, is that this upcoming production of Hadassah, every single note in the show was written by Marilyn. And she has quite a talent for that.
Yeah, and she's going to have a couple people sing from it here in a minute, but we're going to pray first. So let's bow our head and while we pray. Dear Lord, thank you for our church. Thank you how you're blessing it. We ask that your continued blessing upon it. Please be with Pastor Ken, and thank you for his leadership. Guide and protect us in all ways, Lord. Please be with that search committee as we're looking for a new pastor, and give us the right person for that, and have your hand upon it. Give us wisdom. Give that search committee wisdom, please, as they're working through that process. And Lord, there's many people with COVID, Ida and Marianne. We ask that you put your healing touch on them. Help be with them and heal them. Thank you for the good news with Judy and her recent hospital. And there's an unspoken request here, Lord, and we ask that you take care of it, and you know what that is. And we thank you so much for your many blessings. And we're going to say the Lord's Prayer now, and when we get to that part, we're all going to say debts. Okay, here we go. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. So Marilyn, do you want to tell us about the play? Or okay, Charity, come on up. Before Pastor Ken preaches there, this play is this weekend. I'll let her tell you about it.
Good morning. I've been chosen to talk about our show. It's called Hadassah, and it's been written by lovely Marilyn Olson. It's wonderful. It is the story of Esther, if you don't know it. It's a very small book in the Old Testament. It's wonderful, one of my favorites. But it's really just, it's very biblically accurate, straight from the Bible, and it's the story of Esther and her people. And this lovely lady, Sarah, plays Esther. And we have a fill-in for Mordecai, Judah. And so it's not his role, but he's going to do a wonderful job, I'm sure. Y'all should come. It's this weekend. There are flyers. If you talk to any of us, I don't know if there's some out there. But it's going to be a wonderful show.
I will admit, I just ran out of flyers yesterday. But someone else should have flyers. Yeah, I do that too.
Don't come expecting to be bored. It is a very funny show. Expect to boo for Haman and cheer for Mordecai. And it's right during the Feast of Purim, so there may be a big Jewish audience that joins us. I remember the first time we were doing this in Portland, and we didn't understand why there was booing and cheering from the audience. We'd never noticed it before. We thought, what's wrong with this crowd? And we found out that that's what they normally do for the story of Esther. So come and have fun, guaranteed. It's a free show. You don't have to pay anything. It's family friendly. We just want you to come. These kids, all of these kids are in it.
You will most certainly laugh. Come prepared to laugh. It is very funny. It's very good. Very well written.
This is on, right? Okay.
For this season you were born, for such.
Not my part, I apologize.
You were born for such a time as this, born to save your people. For this reason you are his. Your father's house will die. You must go to save your people. Are in your hands, little star, for this season you were born.
For this season I was born, for such a time as this, born to save my people. For this reason
nothing for 3 full days and nights. I and my maidens will do the same. Then I will go to the king, which is against the law.
Overwhelmed. You guys are great. We have another treat for you this morning. We have a video from June Johnson, who is a missionary that we support. She's currently in Germany, and has, anyway, are you up for it, Mike? Okay.
Hello, my name is June Johnson, and I'm a missionary with Christian Missionary Fellowship, and I've been serving in Ukraine for the past 25 years. It is my privilege to be able to give you a snapshot, a peek into what God is doing through you in Ukraine. For the first 16 years, I served in Crimea, which is the southern peninsula of Ukraine, now occupied already 8 years by Russia. During those first 15, 16 years, I did ministry that was basically half and half. Half of the ministry was related to medicine. Because I'm a nurse, a registered nurse with a specialty in wound care, I served through church clinics, did conferences, did staff education, and saw patients as well as a wound care nurse. The other part of my ministry was related to children and youth, not leading those outreaches, but facilitating the bringing the gospel to children and teens through national ministers. When Russia came in and occupied Crimea, I fled on March 1st and returned to the United States. But God returned me to Ukraine a little while later, so that in 2016, I returned to Ukraine, but now in the city of Kyiv, the capital of Ukraine. I have been serving in Kyiv for 6 years, and there my ministry was very different. There I worked in a suburb of the capital called Brovary, and in a church that had an outreach to special needs families. So families that had a member who had autism, wheelchair user, spina bifida, Down syndrome, anything outside the normal spectrum. We were reaching out to those families because in Ukraine, they're often a neglected and very hurting group of people. I also had the opportunity to teach and give workshops at Christian medical conferences. I also traveled around Ukraine to work with other Christian medical outreaches to strengthen their ministry in wound care, in ostomy care, bringing humanitarian aid, and as well as seeing patients and giving consults, sometimes even by Skype. When the war started in February last year, I was already in the States because I was preparing to sit for a certification exam to keep my specialty credentials. 2 weeks after the war started, a group of 40 people evacuated from eastern Ukraine. There, in that group, were 8 wheelchair users that were quadriplegic or paraplegic. Unfortunately, they were not able to evacuate with medical personnel. Therefore, 2 weeks after their arrival, I received a call saying, "Can you come help us?" And within 4 days, I turned around everything in my life and flew to Germany. For this past year, I have been serving this group of people, doing everything from catheter changes, dressing changes, pedicures, translating, going to doctor visits, helping with applications and documents, anything that's needed in the way that I can help, especially medical related. So that's what I've been doing the past year here in Germany. And I anticipate that I would stay here until the war ends and the group is able to return to Ukraine. But that's not all of the ministry that I've been involved in. It has been so exciting to see what God is doing through the local church inside Ukraine. And because I've been in Ukraine already 25 years, I had so many trusted contacts. And so even though I'm here in Germany, ministry through me is still going on in Ukraine, thanks to your support. Let me explain a little bit more. Because of your faithful support, so much is going on, and it's all through the local church, National Believers. It's exciting to me, and I'm proud of Ukraine and the believers there in the way that so again and again and again, those who have been hit, evacuated, lost everything, their first responders are the believers of Ukraine. And they can respond because you gave them money for fuel. You gave them money to repair the cars so they can bring humanitarian aid into the areas that have been freed. You gave money so that they could have surgery. They could get the medicines they need. They could buy the things they need so that the local believers could buy food, hygiene aids, cleaning aids, anything that they needed, and take it into the local people. So it's local people, local believers helping local people. There's just no better way that it could be that God's people in their own language, in their own culture, in their own territory, are reaching out to the non-believers next door and across the country. Because of your faithful support, the National Ukrainian Christians were able to reach out to individuals, to villages, to orphanages, to hospitals, bringing in aid to help them, aid that had been given foreignly or aid that you had provided funding to be able to purchase. I keep all track of all of their receipts and their reports, and you've helped not hundreds, you've helped thousands of people this past year during the war. And it's just me that gets to say thank you. In heaven, you're going to hear a lot more thank you, because God, through you, has reached out to his people. Johnny Erickson Tata, a quote of hers is that God permits what he hates to accomplish what he loves. I don't like this war. I don't understand this war. I want it over. I don't understand the suffering or the length. I can't explain it. But I also can't ignore what God is doing in it. Posts from Facebook friends, articles, verbal testimonies of the people that I work with. There's miracles and miracles and miracles happening there. Why did that person live? Why didn't that mine go off? Why was there help just in time? Why this atheist today sees Christ in his neighbor? I can't explain this war. I don't like this war, but God is using this war for his glory. And for that, I'd say thank you to him. Again, thank you is a small word compared to the feeling that I have. My prayer is that in heaven, you will know the full aspect of how God is working and has worked and will work through you. I can just simply say thank you for your prayers and your faithful support. Until next time.
She is one dynamic lady. You don't want to get in the way. She's got a job to do. She does it. I tell you, it's a privilege for us as a church to support her. Yes, Doc. Thank you. Yeah. Well, if you're visiting with us and you want to record your attendance or you have a prayer request or whatever, you should have a white card in the seat in front of you. You can just drop it in the box back there or the box over here. We do pray for you. We pray for you on a regular basis. Just a little bookkeeping thing. We want to invite you after the service to come to Fellowship Hall. We always have refreshments there. If you go back there today, you will see amazing stuff. Those are brought on a volunteer basis. We need more people to sign up for that. And I have the sign-up sheet right here. I'll leave it on the pulpit after the worship service. If you want to be part of the team that brings refreshments, feel free to come up and sign up. I would encourage you, John is not here this morning, he is ill, but I would encourage you to pray for the search committee. There's some exciting things happening, and you're going to have an announcement one of these days. We're looking forward to that. Well, I think that's all I have in the way of announcements. Have I forgotten something? Probably. As you can tell, I'm losing my voice. I will do my utmost to get through the message. I'll tell you, there's nothing worse than a pastor who can't talk. You know? Take your Bibles, if you will, and open them up to the book of Galatians. You will find that in the New Testament. It is the first of what are called the prison epistles. Once you find that, go to chapter 5. And our text this morning will be Galatians 5, 13 to 18. As is our custom, let us stand for the reading of God's word, shall we? Galatians 5, I'm reading verse 13, I'll read through 18. You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free. But do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather serve one another humbly in love. For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command, love your neighbor as yourself. If you bite and devour each other, watch out, or you will be destroyed by each other. So I say to you, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other. So you are not to do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. You may be seated. When I was a young man, and heard a lot about Christianity, I was firmly convinced that Christianity was all about do's and don'ts. Become a Christian, and you can't do this, and you can't do that, and you can't do that, and you better look like this, and you better look like that, and so forth and so on. And if you didn't conform to the rules, then you weren't really a Christian. Well, the truth is, beloved, Christians are the freest people on the face of the earth. I'll say it to you again. Christians are the freest people on the face of the earth.
Amen.
Paul writes in Galatians, you, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free. And you and I are free because we have the freedom to pursue those things that God would have us pursue. Those things that help us grow and mature as human beings. Truthfully, the Christian has solved the major issue of life. We belong to the Lord. We can go and do and be all that God would have us be. We have an echo this morning, Mike. Can you do anything about that? That's a wonderful realization. Paul goes on to say, though, even though you have freedom, don't abuse it. Don't abuse it. Even though we are Christians and we are free, we are in the midst of a battle. And we've talked about this many times. The warfare takes place in three areas. The world around us, the world in which we live, is diametrically opposed to our Christian lifestyle and value system. Now, you don't want to believe that. I don't want to believe that. But you know, we don't have to look around very far before we realize it is a fact. Amen? Yeah. It grieves me. I'm sure it grieves you. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, all we have to do is look around and realize that I guess what scholars would tell us, we live in a post-Christian age. There is a direct affront against the biblical family structure. And that's a given. So we war against the world in which we live. Secondly, the devil himself prowls around seeking to devour us. That's what God's word said. Temptations abound. Temptations that come wrapped up in nice, beautiful packages. The devil is the great deceiver. And you know, if you want to experience the devil, make a commitment to walk with the Lord and see what happens. Wow. You become an instant target, and that's true. But perhaps our biggest adversary, you and I, is our own flesh. The old nature, Scripture calls it. The selfish nature that says, you don't need God, you are God. You are the king. You are on the throne. You don't have to be subservient to anyone. That nature is so subtle. That's the nature that says, look at the pretty packages. Extend the credit limit. Fill your basic needs. You know, that spiritual knowledge you think you have, that's pomposity. You need to put your faith in yourself, your pride. Well, how do we war against those things? Well, the truth is, were it not for the supernatural work of God, we'd be in deep trouble, and that's a fact. The realization is God has not abandoned us. He's given us careful instruction on how to win these battles that rage all around us and within us. And the solution is radical. Hence the title of our series, Radical Christianity. Now remember, that word radical does not mean what you think it means. It means basically original or fundamental, reaching to the center of the ultimate source. It means a genuine return to basics. My radical Christianity is a return to basics. God says to you and I, you fight the constant war that you're in by remembering the basics, your basic training. Perhaps you remember we began this series by saying that we needed to be Christ-centered, not self-centered. That isn't an easy process. It takes work. Last week, if you recall, we looked at how we do that. To be Christ-centered involves three things: two that we must do, and one that God does for us. Our text was found in Hebrews 12. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Considered him who endured such opposition from sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. You see, first, we have to throw off the sin that entangles. And what is that basic sin? It's the sin of unbelief. Well, we know, but we don't believe. We know, but we don't believe. The sin of unbelief is the foundation of all sin that plagues Christians. If we truly believed God and took him at his word, wouldn't the world be a different place? So first of all, we have to rid ourselves of the sin. Secondly, we need to place our eyes upon Jesus. He is our example, the author and the perfecter of our faith. And thirdly, we must submit or acknowledge the power of his presence. He is here, right here, this morning. He is working. He is available. And through the Holy Spirit, Jesus is actively working in the life of the believer. Not out there somewhere, but right here, here in our hearts. And you and I, we have to stay centered, and we must stay focused. How do we do that in a radical sense? Hence the title of our message this morning, through the D word. It's a word we're not fond of. It's called discipline. It's not a word that you and I like much. I don't. We think discipline is bad. Let me tell you something, the world conditions us that way. God's word would tell us is that discipline is how we grow as Christians. You and I, we think that discipline is the opposite of freedom. It is not. As a matter of fact, discipline leads to freedom. The more discipline I exercise by being Christ-centered and focused upon him, the more freedom that I have. Amen. Amen. the more peace I experience, the more joy, even in the midst of tough circumstances. The more unrestrained I am, the more I am bound by the tyranny of my own nature, truly. And I am bound by sin, and I am entangled. Let me tell you something about sin, beloved. Many of you have checked out right now. You're thinking about the roast at home. You don't want to hear about sin. Let me tell you something about sin. Sin has consequence. It's true. It's true. Discipline leads to freedom. The problem is, discipline takes work. It takes effort. It takes me doing something. The text tells us you and I are called to be free. Let me ask you a question. What does it mean for a Christian to be called? Ginger and I are owned by two Australian shepherds. One is 12 years old, the other is 8. Now, people that know and understand Australian shepherds would tell you this. If you don't give them a job, they'll pick one for themselves. That's a fact. Our Australian shepherds have determined that it is their job to keep track of Mom. If you want to know where Mom is, look for a dog. They know exactly where she is and what she's doing. Now, we live on the Mooloolah River. It's about 150 yards behind our house. And our two Aussies, they love nothing better than to go to the river. And in the summertime, it's a mess. Now the river is too high and they're smart enough not to get in it. When Ginger and I take a walk down the path to go to the river, they of course go with us. And they are here, and they are there, and they are there, and they are there, and they're back there, and over here, and so forth. But all I have to do is go, Sophie, and she is here. Why? She is listening for my call. Let me ask you a question this morning, beloved. Have you heard Jesus call you? Are you listening? Now, I'll tell you something about Buster. Now, he's 8 years old. He is strong as an ox. Sophie is the matriarch. And she works hard. Buster, will come when he hears the call, if he thinks it's important. If it's not important, well, me? Are you talking to me? Oh, what do you want? Oh, it's all right. Don't worry about that. I'll take care of it later. You see, he's ignoring the call. It's easy for you and I to ignore the call of Jesus. What is he calling you and I to do? Think about it. Spend more time in the Word. Reach out to other people. It's right there in the text. We are to love each other. Yeah. It takes discipline, beloved, to hear the call. We have to be listening for it. You see, Sophie, in her wisdom, always has one ear cocked to listen for us. Buster, if it's convenient, maybe not so much. We have to tell periodically that old nature, which is dead, to hush and be quiet and let me listen for the call of Jesus. You say amen to that? Amen. Is that an easy thing to do? No. No. Yeah. You know what it involves? It involves taking us out of the center of the universe, taking ourselves out of the center of the universe, and allowing Jesus to hold his rightful place. Yeah. And how do we do it? Look at the text. By submitting our will to his. And we do it by serving others in his name. That's how we hear the call. The entire law is summed up in a single command. What is it? Love your neighbor as yourself. Paul's writing to a church in Galatia that's destroying itself. Look at verse 15. He says, if you bite and devour each other. Those are powerful words, beloved. If you bite and devour each other, watch out, or you will be destroyed. We've seen that happen, haven't we? It's not a happy thing. So the question is, whose voice are we listening to? Our own or the voice of Jesus? You want to know how we can tell? How is our relationship with other folks? Are we willing to serve? To love our neighbor? Or are we more interested in being right and justified in our own eyes? It takes discipline to overcome the flesh. The Greek word for flesh is sarx. It's not a happy word, is it? Sarx. It just sounds overbearing. The Christian cannot simply will to overcome the flesh. The solution is not to pit our will, my will, against the old nature, but instead to surrender my will to the leading of the Holy Spirit. January 1st, I'm going to lose 40 pounds. And how am I going to do that? Well, I'm going to stop eating chocolate chips and so forth. and I'm going to do it through sheer willpower. Does it work? No. The doc's shaking his head. He's seen it. No, it don't work. How does it work? If I submit my will to the Lord Jesus Christ, that's how we overcome the old nature. Beloved, this is what God means when he says through Paul, live by the Spirit. Let the Holy Spirit of God lead us instead of fighting to take dominion. Submit to the will of God. That's the lesson that we have here this morning, right here in the text. Yeah. If you bite and devour, watch out. You'll be destroyed. So I, Paul, says, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. Well, honey, you walk by the Spirit? You spend time in the Spirit's book and learn what the Spirit says and be open to the call of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for the power of your word and how it speaks to our hearts. Draw us into obedience to you, Lord. We pray these things in your precious name. Amen.
Stand for our last song if you would like to. Stretch those legs and all that good stuff.
Sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry, from the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me. Could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. All my heart to him I give, ever to him I cling. Blessed presence live, ever his praises sing. Love so mighty and so true merits my soul's best songs. Faithful, loving service to him belong. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Lifted me when nothing else could help. Love lifted me. Souls in danger, look above. Jesus completely saves. He will lift you by his love out of the angry waves. He's the master of the sea. Billows his will obey. He your Savior wants to be saved today. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When the else could help. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help.
Love lifted you, say amen.
Amen.
Yes. Let's close with our benediction. Now,
to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever.
Amen.
I want to invite you next door to enjoy the refreshments. Some good stuff there. Good to see you this morning, folks.
Beth, you're wrong here.
You know, it's amazing what
charity wrong.
Marilyn does this twice a year. Creates this and the music and everything.
I'm going to try to go. I'm going to try to get Stephanie in.